Actually, Mr. Krista Anand got his BE degree in Electronics and Communication Engineering and his Master degree in Applied Electronics. He received his PhD degree in Engineering. He has completed his postdoctoral research work in cooperative networks. He has almost spent a decade in research, instructing, counseling, and down-to-earth application improvement. His exploration skill covers image processing, cooperative networks, electromagnetic fields, electronic devices, wireless networks, and medical electronics. He is the recipient of 15 honors and best faculty award, including Best Knowledge Exchange Transfer Initiative of the year 2017. At present, he is a member of 140 professional and social welfare bodies over the globe. He is a biographical world record holder of Marcus, who in the world for his exceptional commitment towards Explore Group from 2015 to 17. He is also a technical advisory board member of nearly 90 national level, international level technical conferences over the globe. Now, I request our resource person, Dr. Krista Anand, to take over the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your brief introduction. Actually, we have been 10 minutes past 2 o'clock over here. And I'm very happy to participate in this ISTE AICT sponsored online 6 days induction refresher program on Anaconda Data Science Techniques. So, special thanks to the coordinator, Dr. S. Matilda, the professor, Department of CSE. IFET College of Engineering, the co-coordinators Mrs. S. Usha Rani, the Associate Professor, Department of CSE, IFET College, and Mr. B. Raj Mohan, who is also the Associate Professor of Department of CSE, IFET College. And very special thanks to Dr. Anand Kumar, who has been a regular collaborator with me. So together we had collaborated for various research publications, conferences, journals, including patents as well, national as well as international patents. And I think he's not present over here, but still, you know, we have been regular collaborators. And I thank the coordinators and the IFET College for giving me a special opportunity to participate as a keynote speaker or as a resource person for this FTP, or so it's called as induction program. So before beginning the session, at least we should take a 1 minute prayer to thank God to keep us safe during this pandemic period, because Omicron has been threatening, and as far as I know, it's the rate of spread has been huge. But still, I would rather say if we stay safe during the pandemic period, I think it would be signaling the end of this pandemic period. So I would not like to waste much of my time, and I am going to go straight into my session. Is my screen visible to you?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
So I hope my screen is visible to you and my voice is audible for everybody.
Yes, sir.
Yes, everything is clear, sir.
Right. Okay, so warm welcome to everybody. So this has been my topic of preference, this Python for data science. And this is especially for you, my dear faculty members, learned scholars, researchers, scientists, and young researchers, you know, in and around the globe. And this is Dr. Krista Anand for you. And you can reach me at dr.kristaanand@gmail.com. So before beginning the session, let us all remember God for just a minute. As for me, I thank God for giving me this golden opportunity to deliver this useful session, to share my knowledge among my fellow national, international participants, students, learned scholars, faculty members, and young researchers. So thank you, my dear officials and the head of the department, who understood this need to initiate fruitful outcome on teaching, learning and education. And thank you, my dear colleagues and fellow participants, who understood the necessity to support this valuable session by your utmost valuable presence, and without you the event would not have been possible. So this is what we are going to discuss at a glance. We are going to discuss about why learn Python for data science, because yes, of course everybody would have a short introduction, but still you should understand why you should learn Python for data science, and how to learn Python for data science, how long will it take to learn Python, and where can I learn Python for data science. So you can ask a question to yourself: is Python generally necessary in the data science field? Is Python better than R for data science? And we will have a simple program about how to check a number, whether it is a spy number or not. And we will discuss about the significance of Jupyter Notebook. And I'll discuss some suggestions, some valuable suggestions about the steps to become a data scientist. Of course, at regular intervals, we will have some short videos to discuss the knowledge in our topics. So we will have a short introduction about why you have to learn Python for data science. So before exploring, before getting into Python for data science, we actually have to brief about why we should learn Python. And then we go for why we should learn Python for data science. So in short, you can say that if you are getting in touch with Python, or maybe if you are understanding Python, so definitely it is considered as a valuable skill. You can become a data programmer, you can become a data scientist, and who knows, you can land yourself in your dream company or maybe your dream job. You can pursue your data science career. So you can confidently say that Python is the programming language of choice for data science. So when you think about data science, Python should be the first choice. So actually in 2016, it overtook R for data science on Kaggle, the premium platform for data science competitions. And in 2017, it overtook R on the KD Nuggets annual poll of data scientists, which are considered as the most used tools. And in 2018, 66% of the overall data scientists reported using Python daily. So which means that everybody are showing much interest on this analytical professionals on this Python for data science. So data science experts, they have predicted to continue with the increasing development in Python ecosystem. So the journey continues, you know, there are several broad opportunities that are open up. So still the carrier, you know, the entire scenario is expected to boom in coming years. According to Indeed, a popular media, the average salary for data scientists is $121,583. Okay, I think you know about this Indeed profile. Like many job seekers try to have a profile over here, and you can actually calculate the basic salary, median salary, and the maximum salary. Think about the average salary. It is $121,583. Normally, we people, you know, they abroad, maybe we would go, maybe maximum it might go up to $3,000 per month, okay, for faculty members, or maybe somebody who's working in a normal company or maybe industry field, they would go up to $3,000 per month. Maybe it may uptake up to $36,000 per year. Okay, think about $121,000 per year. Okay, so approximately it is going to take some $10,000 per month. Okay, so if you have some, you know, real interest in becoming a data scientist, your returns are huge. And that number is only expected to increase as demand for data scientists is expected to keep growing. If you analyze the statistics in 2021, because 2021 is going to be over, okay, still there are some huge booms that are coming up in 2022, and in 2021 there are three times as many job postings in data science. And very recently I come across, like in Germany, there are too much of wanted for this data scientist. Okay, So job searches for data science has been huge according to Quantum, and this means that the demand for data scientists is vastly outstripping the supply, which means that we lack professionals who know the real knowledge. Okay, so if you are going to become a data scientist, now job openings are huge, salary is going to be huge. So the future is bright for data science, and Python is just one piece of proverbial pie. Fortunately, learning Python and other programming fundamentals is as attainable as ever. So I'll try to show you some 5 simple steps about why you have to learn Python for data science. But remember, it is because the steps are simple, doesn't mean that you have to put in the work. Okay. So if you try to apply yourself, or maybe you dedicate some time to learn Python, you have the potential. Maybe if you are not going to pick up new skill, but definitely you can think about Python for data science as a career, as a initiative, or maybe a beginning of a new start. And how to learn Python for data science? First of all, you have to identify the right course to help you learn Python programming. Courses are there specifically in the internet, okay, for learning Python for data science at your own speed, okay, challenging you to write real code and use real data in an interactive in-browser interface. And in addition to learning Python in a course setting, your journey to become a data scientist should also include soft skills. So whenever you are going for any job, for any dream company, the first thing they will ask, do you have any soft skills or do you have any experience? So they will be testing your soft skills. Okay. Also, they would be testing your technical skills as well. But still, you know, soft skills are very much interesting. Very much needed for learning this Python. So the step one, first of all, you understand or maybe you learn the Python fundamentals. Maybe you can start it from anywhere. Okay, so first thing, you should learn the Python programming basics, and maybe you can also have an introduction to data science. So one of the most important tools is Jupyter Notebook. Have a note of it, Jupyter Notebook, which comes pre-packaged with Python libraries to help you learn these two things. You can actually join a community. Maybe you can have a WhatsApp group, or maybe a Facebook, or maybe a Twitter group. Even in the courses you try to pursue, you will have a community, an app, where you will put yourself around like-minded people and increase your opportunities for employment. My suggestion is that first of all, don't go for employment. First of all, you try to master the topic. Master the area where you are trying to boom into the field, and then you go for the employment, okay, because you have to test your knowledge. And according to the Society for Human Resource Management, employee referrals account for 30% of all hires. Okay, so 70% you are going to try on your own, there are some chances that 30% you can go with the employee referral. So what you do, as simple as that, you create a Kaggle account, join a local meetup group, and participate in any learner community with the current students and alums. And maybe you can also go for CLI, command line interface, which lets you to run scripts more quickly and allows you to test programs faster and work with more data. So the first step is learn the Python fundamentals. And the second thing, you try to practice more and more mini Python projects. So hands-on learning, everybody tries to refer, okay, everybody tries to practice with hands-on learning. So you may be surprised by how soon you will be able to build some Python projects. So at the start, what we do, we try to compile it for the beginners, but maybe think about this way, okay, maybe you can track and analyze your personal Amazon.com spending habits. Okay, because maybe there are some commodities you will try to buy often. Okay, there are some commodities you will try to buy within a month. So you try to track, you try to analyze your personal spending habits. Think about a fun project that will help you to practice Python and maybe Pandas basics as well, while it will give you a specific insight into your personal finance. Also, you try to analyze the data from a survey, find a public survey data, or maybe use a survey data from your own work in the beginner project. That will definitely teach you to drill down into answers to mine, you know, the insights into that particular project. Or maybe you can try any one of the guided projects, maybe interactive Python projects for every skill level. It uses real data and offer guidance while, you know, still challenging you to apply your skills in new ways. But still, you can also go with trying programming things like calculators for an online game. Okay, so start with a simple Minesweeper game. Okay, or maybe a simple, you know, calculator for an online game or a program that fetches the weather from Google in your city. You can build, you know, simple games, you know, apps. Still, you know, apps and games is going to, you know, broaden your circle when you are learning this Python for data science. And building mini projects like this will definitely help you learn Python. So go for many mini projects. Okay. So this projects, or maybe these mini projects, definitely it will be considered as a very important standard, and it will help you to strengthen your basics. Okay. So only if you try to experience, or maybe build your experience with the application program interfaces, definitely you can begin with a very important term called as web scraping. Okay, so web scraping is definitely useful for gathering this data, and it will help you to strengthen your basics in the Python program. So, as I would, you know, conclude with this mini Python projects, you try to enhance your coursework and find the answers for the Python programming challenges. Maybe you will have like several programs, like maybe you know, write a simple Python program for any app, for any blog post, or maybe, you know, some stuff out of it. So there's one important book or maybe one important literature that you can go through. You can have a note of it. Automate the boring stuff with Python. Automate the boring stuff with Python by A.I. Swigert. You have a note of it. Automate the boring stuff with Python. It's actually a very excellent, and it will be having a fun-filled way of learning Python. So. It's totally free. You can go with that book, Automate the Boring Stuff with Python by A.I. Swigert. So you can go through these several, you know, several projects, some real-time examples. Also, there is a data science handbook also. It's a great collection of interviews with working data scientists. So they will be giving some experience. You will get a better idea about what real data science work is actually about. And you can how you can actually succeed in this field. Okay, so data science handbook will be giving you some interviews with the data scientists, and you will have a Python data science handbook. It's a helpful guide that is available in the convenient you know, Jupyter notebook for free. You can see it in the GitHub platform, where you can dive in and you can run all the sample code for yourself. And there are elements of statistical learning. You will have a statistics textbook that will serve you as a reference while learning Python to make sure your work is statistically valid. Okay. And you can also go with learning the Python data science libraries. Maybe in the case of Python, maybe that's a best way of doing something. So you can have NumPy or maybe Pandas or maybe Matplotlib. Okay. So there are some at most like 15 most important Python libraries for data science. You have like NumPy, which has a variety of mathematical and statistical operations. It's being included in the Pandas library. Then you have Pandas. We have a library dedicated specifically to facilitate working with data. And we have Matplotlib. It's a, you know, a visualization library where you can generate charts from your data. And you have Scikit-learn. We have the machine learning framework in this Python. So you can have a note of NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, and Scikit-learn as well. So if you consider these libraries, you can consider NumPy and Pandas to be greatly used by data scientists. And you don't know what you don't know. That's the thing. You don't know what you don't know. So only thing you, if you practice more and more mini projects, or maybe learn data science libraries one by one, then you will get to know your real knowledge. And Python has a rich community of experts who are eager to help you learn Python. And of course, you have like Agora, a platform where you can ask any questions and you can get the answers. Stack Overflow, Learner Community are some of these examples where you have full active people excited to share the knowledge and you can learn Python programming. Of course, with any Python, you will have like Git, or only GitHub, which is a popular tool which helps you keep track of the changes made to your code, which helps you to identify the mistakes, detect the mistakes, or maybe correct the mistakes, experiment it, analyze it, or maybe you can collaborate with others. Okay. So you can think about some projects, you know, some user level projects where you can strengthen the basics of the Python data science libraries. So as you learn Python, it's very essential that you try to practice and you try to build a data science portfolio. We have something called Interfolio, where it's a platform where you can submit your resumes, or maybe you can submit your job applications. Similarly, you can build a data science portfolio for aspiring data scientists. A portfolio is a matter of presentation, or maybe it's a matter of showcase. So this portfolio, something like projects, should include work with several different data sets and should leave the readers with several insights that you are trying to build. Some examples I am trying to give it to you: data cleaning project, data visualization project, and machine learning project. Okay. If you take in the case of a data cleaning project, it involves dirty or maybe unstructured data that you try to clean it up and you try to analyze with the potential employers. Since most real world data is going to require cleaning, so you cannot say every project is perfect. Okay. So there are some unstructured data that you can clean it up, okay, with some analyzing features. And you can go with data visualization project also. So make it trendy, make it attractive, make it easy to read visualizations. So you apply the programming, you apply the design challenges, the knowledge that you have studied, and you know, have some good looking charts, trending charts in your project, so that your portfolio stands in front of others. And you can also think about a machine learning project. Suppose if you think about becoming a data scientist, so definitely you can study ML, machine learning. And one important thing that you should note is the Jupyter Notebook. Okay, so it's all about, you know, mastering the code. The advantage is that, you know, non-technical people can follow along with your charts and written explanations, and need not have a, you know, a bright theme, even a simple theme with some data sets, you know, that's interesting to the people. But if you think about working in a company or maybe industry, you know, building some projects such as these with the help of a portfolio is a very good idea, and displaying the projects definitely will invite some data scientists to collaborate with you. So who knows, you know, the future employers might turn out in any way, okay, just like a webinar, or maybe just like a development program, a refresher course, somebody will try to come along with you, somebody will try to recruit you. Who knows, applying your programming skills, you might land in your dream job. And one of the important things is that you try to, whatever you have, the soft skills you have, you collaborate with others. Okay, as in my tagline, it says collaboration is everything. So you collaborate with others, so you try to build a very good project that is, you know, very much useful for the government even. And while learning Python for data science, you will have to have a solid background in statistics. So without statistics, you cannot become a data scientist for sure. So understanding statistics, definitely you will have the mindset to focus on the right things, and you can find valuable insights rather than just executing the code. And apply advanced data science techniques. So sharpen your skills. So any field you take, okay, maybe it's data science or maybe machine learning or maybe Python, you have to constantly learn. You have to have some passion. You have to have some interest. So it should not come out of compulsion. Okay, you should have some interest to it. Okay, maybe you will forget your breakfast, you will forget your lunch, you will forget your dinner. Okay, so you should have some passion, you should have some interest. And in the internet, you are gifted with several advanced courses that you can complete to ensure that you have covered all the bases. And you have to be comfortable with the statistics. As I told you, regression analysis, classification, K means, KC means, okay, you should learn. You should get in touch with the machine learning. You know, several bootstrapping models, okay, the Django projects, creating neural networks using scikit-learn, okay. So when you try to create as many models like newspaper app, okay, using live data feeds, or maybe you can, you know, go with predictions, okay, several predictions with the case of developing the projects, or maybe taking the standards to the next higher level. So data science, as you can see, it's a ever-growing field that spans numerous industries. So at the rate the demand is increasing, there are exponential opportunities, you know, broad opportunities. So continue reading, continue collaborating, continue programming, continue conversing with others, be sure to maintain an interest, and definitely you can sustain in a competitive world. Some interest. And there are a lot of estimates about how long it actually takes to learn Python. For data science specifically, it will take maybe some less than 3 months, maybe two a year. Maybe if you are dedicating very less time for a day, then definitely it will take a year. But you know, think about the fruit. Think about the fruit that you are going to get. It's going to be very tasty, and you are going to enjoy it. And I watched, you know, several people over the years for taking online courses at lightning speed, okay, and others for taking much slower. Maybe their speed is relatively high. Some are slow and steady. They go, okay. So it all depends on your desired timeline, and about the free time that you have, and you dedicate to the Python programming, and at what speed or maybe what pace you are trying to learn. And there are several online courses that are available. Each path is full of lessons. You have hands-on learning approach. You have several opportunities to ask questions. You have the several opportunities to, you know, develop the community, join the community, develop the community, and take it to your dream job. So you can have an in-depth mastering of the data science fundamentals. So where can I learn this Python for data science? And there are tons of Python learning resources. Okay, so I'm not trying to stand for any brand, but if you are looking to learn it for data science, it's best to choose somewhere that teaches data science specifically. Okay, so because Python is also used in a variety of other programming disciplines, from game development to the mobile apps. So generic learn Python resources generally will teach you something basics out of it. Generally, it will help you to analyze, go with the data analytics even. And if you are struggling through a course that's actually teaching you to build a game for Python, maybe you will get frustrated and you will quit this program. You will quit this entire online learning. But if you go with the basics, go with the data analysis, okay, then you master the basics, and then you go with small mini projects. Okay, master these mini projects, go with several examples, and then finally, if you go with any gaming or maybe some real-time projects, so definitely you will find it helpful. You will find it very easy to master. And there are a lot of free
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, I am having a tough time actually with multispectral image analysis. So
okay.
I want to do it with Python. So I need to know basics starting from the scratch. Can you suggest any courses or some material, online resources?
So actually, with the case of, yes, I think I've given some. I think you can go with this one. Automate the boring stuff with Python by AI Swigert. DataQuest is also one such platform where you can get some ideas. These two platforms definitely will help you get an answer to start from the scratch.
This book and which one?
DataQuest. DataQuest is good. Where it will be giving you some fun examples even. When you have access to NumPy, you know, Pandas, Matplotlib even. You have the access to all the data science libraries. Still, you can embed with the Jupyter notebook. That's also good. That's also good in developing some good projects, good real-time projects. Maybe if you are going through this one, definitely you will get an idea. Maybe it will kindle something out of it and you can help do your project better. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay.
So, if you don't want to pay, there are several YouTube videos are there, but still, you know, there are some free courses that are also available that helps you to learn Python. But these can be a very good option. Okay. So, maybe if you are so serious about it, maybe maybe it might turn into a platform. We'll have some interactive features with it, with a curriculum that is constructed to guide you, so definitely it will be helping you to learn things better. Okay. So as I told you, DataQuest is one such platform. Literature book is also available. The thing is that we have been too much into the online that we forget to read the books. We forget to read the literatures. There are plenty of the literatures that are available. Even the hard copy books will help you gather much knowledge about the subject. And even you can plan to be a data scientist using either Python or maybe R. And each language has its own strength and weakness. So you cannot say this is the best. Okay. So Python is more popular, but still you can, if you compare it with R, R dominates in some industries, especially in the academia field and the research field. But other than that, Python is good. Okay. And to do data science work, you will definitely need to learn at least one of these two languages, either R or maybe Python. Especially for the data science. And it doesn't have to be a Python, but it does have to be either Python or R. Okay, so don't get in touch, you know, too deep into Python. Maybe go with learn Python to master something else. Okay, learn Python, okay, to build a major project. Okay, or you can go with R platform team. So that's a common question that's arising. Is Python better than R for data science? Okay. This has been a constant topic of discussion, whether Python is better or maybe R is better. Okay. So it all depends on the application area where you are trying to use. So R, if you speak about R, generally it will have some regression analysis or maybe statistics or mathematics, too much of statistics and mathematics into it. And there are some good packages where you can use it for data science. And we have a supporting online community even. You know, make sure that you maintain the discipline. Okay. And Python is a much better language for all around work. Meaning that your Python skills should be transferable to other disciplines. So you should not be able to apply to one such field alone. Okay. So you should, your area, your collaboration work should be broad enough to apply in all fields. Okay. And it's, of course, it's a popular platform. And how is Python used for data science? So if you take in the case of using Python or maybe SQL, you write a query normally to pull the data you need to. So using Python and the Pandas library, you sort the data into data frame that's ready for analysis. And using Python and the Pandas and the Matplotlib libraries as well, you can analyze, you can structure, you can explore, you can research, you can visualize the data what you're looking for. So, if you try to use this Python and the Skite Learn library that we actually saw in the video, you can build a predictive model. For example, you can build a newspaper app model that generally focuses the future outcomes from your company. So, this is a very much useful way when you are trying to bring your company to the next higher level. Yes, do you have any questions? I see some noise in the background noise over there. And you can arrange with your final analysis, establishing a collaboration with your co-workers, and definitely Python is a very good choice for data science. I would like to give you a simple example about how to check a number, whether it is a spy number or not. So that's a simple program. I would like to kindle some programming knowledge out of it. So generally, if you have to write a Python program to check a number, whether it is a spy number or not, using a for loop. Okay, so this is actually a basic out of it. Okay. So maybe researchers like us, we will start from the basics. Okay. For example, if the sum of the digit equals the product of the individual digit number. Okay, maybe let us take in the case 1111, like four ones. Okay, the sum is actually 4. But the product is actually 1, so it's not a spy number. Okay. So in this Python spy number example, maybe you can use a while loop to divide the number into digits and find the sum, and you can find the product of the digits. And this if statement checks whether the sum equals the product, and if this sum of the number is equal to the product of the number, then it's true. And
please keep your switch off your mic.
I request the participants to please be more professional, because
We have muted, sir. Please proceed, sir. Thank you.
The other participants are also listening, because I might disturb them. Okay, right. So this is a Python program to check a number, whether it is a spy number. So you can give with the initialization of number, int of input, enter the number to check the spy number, temp the temporary the number, sum equal to 0, you are going to initialize, and product equal to 1. And you have a while loop, while temporary number is greater than 0. So you give the last digit, okay, temp modulus 10, sum is equal to sum plus last digit, and product equal to product multiplied by last digit. So only when you go with the sum, when you initialize the sum with the sum added to the last digit and the product multiplied by the last digit, you get the temporary value, okay, temp, okay, slash 10. Okay, so you are going to print the sum of the digits, and you are going to print the product of the digits. And if this sum is equal to product, okay, so first of all, you are going to go with addition. Maybe if you are going with maybe 1241, let us take in the case. Okay. 1241, okay, 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 1, okay, that it is taken, okay. And then 1 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 4 multiplied by 1, okay, that also is taken. And if this sum is equal to this product, you are going to print it is a spy number, okay. Else, you are going to print it as it is not a spy number. So, the same thing you can also compare or maybe test your programming skills using the recursion or maybe recursive functions. Same thing, total equal to 0, product equal to 1, remainder equal to 0, and you are going to define the spy number. Okay, global remainder, total and product, and if number is greater than 0, remainder is equal to number modulus 10. So total, you are going to compute total plus remainder, product multiplied by remainder, and you are going to go with the spy number printing. Okay, return total product, else maybe you return with a 0. So the program, the way is different, but the actual idea is the same. So what I'll do, maybe I can run an online compiler. Maybe you need not have to install this Python. Maybe as a simple case, maybe you can go with the online Python compiler. So what I do, is telling me this. It is not a spoiler. It is a spy number, so I can actually check whether it is a spy number or not. Same thing, you can elaborate once again. Okay, maybe you can go with another version of it, a Python program which prints the spy numbers from 1 to n, or spy numbers within one particular range. Maybe let us take in the case 1 till 1 lakh or 1 till 10,000. So you're going to print it. Okay. So what you're going to do, you're going to define the minimum spy. Okay. Int of input, please enter the minimum spy value. Maximum spy, int of input, please enter the maximum spy value. So you're going to input the minimum spy value and maximum spy value. For I in range, minimum spy and maximum spy plus 1. Temp equal to I, temp number, okay, equal to I, sum equal to 0 and product equal to 1. You're going to use the while loop, while temp is greater than 0, last digit is equal to temp modulus 10. So you're going to compute the sum, sum equal to sum plus last digit, product equal to product multiplied by last digit. Okay, finally you're going to go with temp slash double slash 10. And if this sum equal to product, print I, you know, end of the complete loop. Okay. So what you do, the same thing I'm trying to go to the second example. So this example is all about minimum and maximum spy value. So you are going to print the spy numbers within a particular range. Minimum spy value, let us take in the case I am giving 1. Maximum spy value, let us take in the case, okay, I'm going to print it up to 10,000. So it is going to print the spy number, okay, away from 1 till it will go up to 10,000. Okay, so we can check with this one. We can go in touch with the, you know, several examples. It will definitely help you to. Now I am going to go in touch with the Jupyter notebook. So that's very important part in today's session. So earlier it was called as IPython notebook, and it's actually a flexible tool that helps you to create a readable analysis. You can keep the code, images, commands, formulae, plots together. So Jupyter is quite extensible. It supports several programming languages, and you can easily host it in your computer, you know, in any server. Okay, only thing, you should have the HTTP access or maybe the SSH access. Okay, the thing is that Jupyter notebook is completely free. You can, you know, search for it and you can access it, you can use it in your projects. And then comes Project Jupyter, which comes inbuilt with the IPython notebook or maybe the Jupyter notebook. So Project Jupyter was born out of the IPython project. It is considered to be a project, maybe it is developed into a notebook that could support multiple languages. Generally, you will have Julia, Python, R. So that comes Jupyter. Okay, Julia, Python, R. Okay. So IPython kernel is being used over here. You will have easy access to all the IPython features within the Jupyter notebooks. And here comes a very much important topic: steps to become a data scientist. So first of all, step one, you have to start with the basics. Set up your machine. Now that you have made up your mind, okay, I need to become a data scientist. Don't think about backing up. Okay, don't think about backing it at any point of time. Okay, even in life, when situations turn up very hard, remember you still have a community of people who have less knowledge than you. Okay, so the thing is that first thing you should think about, you know, build up or maybe set up your own machine, and the easiest way is to download Anaconda from continuum.io. Generally, it comes handy with packaging with several other features. Okay, but the thing is that you have to wait for the Continuum to update all the packages. And if it is done, you can go with several updates. Maybe if you are a beginner, maybe you will think about some hard things, but it doesn't matter. You have to set up your own machine. Okay, so you have to download it. And the second thing, you have to go with basics of Python language. So you should understand the basics of the language, the several Python libraries, the data structure that is involved. And we have a free course, Analytics Vidya on Python. Have a note of it, Analytics Vidya on Python. Remember I gave AI Stay What? That's also literature. Analytics Vidya on Python, it's the best places to start your journey. And if you start about the courses, it focuses on how to get started with Python for data science. And by the end, you should be comfortable with the basic concepts of the language. What you do, you can take the free Python course by Analytics Vidya. Analytics Vidya on Python. Okay. Still, you can go with Google Class for Python. That's also an alternate way of learning for becoming a data scientist. And learn regular expressions in Python. So as I told you, regularly you keep in touch, whether it may be data cleansing, especially if you are working on text data. And if you want to go with regular expressions, you can have a cheat sheet, so that you can use the Google Class for ease. And then you learn the scientific libraries, as I discussed in the videos. You can go with NumPy, SciPy, Matplotlib and Pandas. You will have several examples, you know, hands-on training sessions. It will be forming a good foundation for things to come. So you can look at the SciPy tutorials, go through the introduction, go through the basics. Okay, and maybe if you are going with Matplotlib tutorials as well, then you are at the wrong path. So first of all, you look with the SciPy tutorials and then go with the next. Then finally go with the Pandas. So the Pandas, it provides data frame functionality just like R platform for Python. And practice with the case of analytics, statistic, regression, okay, analysis techniques. Start with a short introduction, then 10 minutes to Pandas, then go with the more and more tutorials and Pandas. And finally the end part, learn scikit-learn and then machine learning. So summarizing, I can say NumPy, SciPy, Matplotlib, Pandas, then comes scikit-learn and then finally machine learning. Okay. So scikit-learn is the most useful library on Python for machine learning. We'll go through the overview of machine learning, you know, several supervised learning algorithms, the neural networks, artificial neural networks, non-supervised learning algorithms like clustering based approaches. You can go with scikit-learn. Okay. And finally, machine learning. So practice. It's just a matter of practice that it helps to collaborate with the other researchers and other fellow data scientists on the Data Hack platform. Dive into live competitions. You can go participate in several competitions on the Data Hack and Kaggle platform. Just go for a try. Okay, only then you will know what knowledge you have. And finally, deep learning. Okay, so you have learned most of the machine learning techniques. It is time that you have to go with deep learning. It's a good platform about deep learning. Still go with a brief introduction, practice more and more examples, tutorials, and then jump into real projects. Okay, so if you say with the case of deep learning, still I'm a beginner. Okay, with the case of deep learning, you can go with deeplearning.net. That's a very useful platform, deeplearning.net. You'll find lectures, data sets, challenges, tutorials. Even there's a course, an online course from Jeff Hinton, the neural networks by Jeff Hinton. That's also a course about where you can study deep learning and you can master it. Session, I should tell you that tell to yourself, I am entirely responsible. I have to initiate. I have to do things on my own. And I have to give promotion for whatever I have. Okay. You need not have a third party to do all these things. Okay. So you should stand in your own leg at all times. Okay, so if you are planning to become a data scientist, repeatedly I'm telling you, don't sit a back foot. Okay, instead, whatever situations you face, you should stand whatever you want to, and remember, whatever you are trying to pursue, try to think about the salary you get. Okay, so the salaries are huge, $1 million to $2 million per year. Okay, so definitely roughly around like 10 lakh you are going to earn out of a month. So who doesn't want to? Okay, and thank you for your kind patience, and once again I thank the management of IAPT College for giving such a golden opportunity. And I would never say that I have given you all the knowledge out of it. Maybe on a scale of maybe 1 to 10, I can say I have given 0.5% of the knowledge. But I have given you some good interest about the scope to improve, scope to study, where to learn, why it is essential, and what are the jobs we are going to get out of the Python for data science. So we researchers can flourish even in the teaching career, even in the research field, even in the programming field, because that's what the government, the company, the industry, the organization is looking for. Okay, so you have to be a multi-talented personality in order to strengthen your base in your career. Okay, so let's start working, and thank you everybody for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the outstanding session. Participants, if you have any queries, you can unmute yourself, and our resource person is ready to answer your questions. And thank you, sir. Thank you for enlightening us and for being an ideal example of inspiration and motivation for all of us. It will definitely help us in future. Thank you, sir.
Participants, do you have any queries?
So participants, you can raise your hand or you can unmute yourself and ask if you have any queries. Or you can also put them in the chat box.
I am happy that the maximum list still stays, because normally like if the participant strength is maybe 80 and maybe at the end of the session it will be 40 or maybe 30. I am happy that the same strength has been continuing, so I can see the interest among the participants in all the sessions.
Yeah, surely the way you have presented is also the reason that participants are interested to listen it, sir. Thank you, sir.
It's okay.
Thank you. Participants, we have posted the feedback and quiz link. You can fill the same. We have shared the quiz and feedback link in the chat box. Hope today's session would have been informative and valuable.
There's only one thing that I would like to share. Earlier were the days when it comes to conference or maybe workshop or maybe webinar or maybe faculty development program or maybe refresher course, we just participate just for the case of attendance. Okay. But nowadays you have to be smart enough that whenever you participate in a meeting or maybe a session, try to think in the business aspect. Maybe build a large circle, a circle of good people, a circle of technical people, where you can take your career to the next higher level. Okay, so utilize maximum out of each session that you are trying to participate, and maybe you can develop a community which can take you to any greater level. So it is all about the community, or maybe it is all about the link. It is all about the number of useful contacts that you have in your phone that you can think about any businesses, any even the data science career that you are trying to pursue. Okay, any career that you are trying to have will have a list of stronger, motivational, encouraging, friendly, helpful, supporting people. Okay. I'm happy that I'm getting some IAPT college people, even some several university people. Okay, so the collaboration should be throughout your life. So if you are having that, so definitely you will have some good time. So that's the thing I would like to share. And yes, I enjoyed the session with all the faculty members and the researchers over here.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for joining with us today.
Thank you.
That was a nice presentation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Yes, participants, we have shared the feedback link and the test link. That is the test link in the chat box. Please fill the same.